Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to a special edition 30-minute webcast in our Workplace Spotlight series, Understanding and Preparing for the New Overtime Rule Changes. We're excited all of you could join us today. My name is Karen Rasmussen, and I'll be introducing our speakers and reviewing a few housekeeping items, and then we'll get the presentation started. This is a live streaming event and is being recorded. We'll send you a link to the recording 24 hours after the webinar. To listen to the audio, please plug your headphones into your computer or smart device, or alternatively, make sure your speakers are turned up. While we will not be answering questions until the end of the webcast time permitting, questions may be submitted anytime during the webcast by entering your question in the Q&A text field and clicking submit. I would also like to encourage you to complete our short survey by clicking on the checklist survey icon at the bottom of the screen. And a PDF of this presentation is available for download in the resource list next to the presentation slides. And before I introduce today's speakers, I just want to review our legal disclaimer. Today's presentation is not legal or tax advice. Before taking any actions on the information contained in this presentation, employers should review this material with their counsel. And keep in mind that what we're discussing today is not the final word on any of these topics. Regulations and legislation change, and employers need to comply with current laws. And also, nothing is intended to be a political opinion. ADP has over 60,000 employees and over 600,000 clients across the political spectrum. Our role is to assist employers with their compliance responsibilities. And with that, I'd like to introduce today's speakers, Sushma Tripathi and Stacey Williams. Sushma serves as Vice President in ADP's Strategic Advisory Services. She is responsible for workforce management consulting and thought leadership to support ADP clients across all human capital management services. She brings more than two decades of experience in leadership, operations, and product management, primarily in health and productivity management, employee benefits administration, and wellness outsourcing. Stacey is Compliance Counsel for ADP National Account Services. Stacey has been a practicing attorney for nearly 20 years, representing employers both at large law firms and as an in-house counsel. She is a frequent speaker on topics related to employment law and compliance. And with that, Sushma and Stacey, I know you have a lot to talk about today, so I'll turn the event over to you.
Well, thank you, Karen, and welcome everyone to today's session, Understanding and Preparing for the New Overtime Rule Changes. Now, we have a short 30-minute session today, and we will cover the long-awaited FLSA final rules that revise the minimum salary level for the white-collar overtime exemptions. Now, one thing to keep in mind is that it's more important than ever to be sure you have a handle on compliance, because overtime already is a very litigious matter. Now, the effective date for the increase a threshold is January 1st, 2020, so the time to prepare for this change is now. In this webinar, we will cover the implications of these changes and provide insights into the latest DOL guidance, along with what employers need to do now in order to prepare. So our agenda today starts with understanding the FLSA exemption test, where we will discuss the requirements for proper classification of employee job categories in light of the upcoming rule change. And then the Department of Labor or the DOL's final rule change and how it might impact your workforce. We will close today with key considerations and best practices for tracking and managing regular and overtime hours worked. So let's get started by giving our audience a quick refresher on the FLSA. So the Fair Labor Standards Act, or FLSA, was originally passed in 1938 as a part of the New Deal, and almost every employee in the United States is subject to the FLSA. Now, the FLSA is enforced by the United States Department of Labor, or the DOL. So, Stacey, can you tell us a little bit more about the FLSA and its requirements? What should our audience keep in mind as they prepare for the new overtime rule changes?
Well, the major areas covered by the FLSA include overtime and minimum wage obligations, child labor restrictions, the Equal Pay Act, which prohibits discrimination based on sex in the payment of wages, and it also includes record-keeping requirements. Today, though, we're going to be discussing the portion of the FLSA that establishes minimum wage and overtime requirements for non-exempt employees, because that's the portion of the law that's affected by the new rules published by the DOL in late September of this year.
So, Stacey, do the updates made by the DOL apply to exempt employees?
No, the changes only apply to employees classified as non-exempt under the FLSA, which is why it's so important for employers to make sure they're correctly classifying their employees. And we'll go over exempt versus non-exempt in a moment.
Well, thank you, Stacey. So, as most of you know, the FLSA is a federal law that includes requirements that certain employees be paid a minimum wage and time and a half for hours worked in excess of 40 per work week. Now, some employees are exempt from these rules, but in order to be exempt, an employee needs to meet certain requirements. Now, the most common FLSA exemptions are the so-called white-collar exemptions, that is the executive, administrative, and professional exemptions. So, Stacey, can you tell us a little bit more about what tests an employee must meet to be considered exempt under the white-collar exemption?
Sure. To be exempt from the minimum wage and overtime requirements of the FLSA under one of the white-collar exemptions, an employee needs to meet the requirements of three separate tests. The salary basis test requires that an employee be paid on a salary basis. This is pretty straightforward, but it does mean that employers cannot take deductions from the wages of these salaried employees, or they could lose the exemption. There are a few limited exceptions to this rule, such as for unpaid FMLA leave, but generally, salaried employees must be paid their entire salary for each week in which they perform any work. The duties test requires that employees must meet certain requirements pertaining to their job duties, which we'll cover briefly in the next slide. And finally, the salary level test requires that employees must earn a certain minimum salary in order to be considered exempt. This is the requirement that is the subject of the most recent update.
Well, thank you, Stacey. Now, on your screen, you can see a high-level overview of the duties test for the three most common white-collar exemptions, the executive, administrative, and professional exemptions, also known as the EAP. Now, this topic is highly fact-specific and so complex that we could do several hours-long webinar on the duties test for the FLSA alone. Now, the requirements are summarized on your screen, but since we only have 30 minutes today, we are not going to get into the specific requirements of the duties test. But here, you know, what we can tell you today is actually that you can be rest assured that the duties test portion of the FLSA regulation is actually unchanged and not affected by the latest updates by the DOL. So, Stacey, is there anything our audience needs to know about the EAP exemption? Specifically, you know, starting out with independent contractors, which is a hot topic these days.
Yeah, we do get a lot of questions about that. And we get the question of regarding the application and limitations of the white-collar exemptions. And so we'd like to cover them here. So to your question, the EAP exemptions do not affect or apply to independent contractors. And that's because the FLSA itself applies only to employees, and independent contractors are, by definition, not employees.
So, you know, another question we often get is whether the EAP exemptions apply to nonprofit organizations. So what about them?
The EAP exemptions apply to nonprofits in the same way they apply to other employers, with the same rules and the same limitations.
And, you know, what about institutions of higher education? For example, the state and local government employees, what about them?
The white-collar exemptions also apply to institutions of higher education and also to state and local governments. Remember, however, that some employees of these organizations, such as teachers, are not eligible for overtime on the basis of the duties test alone, and thus they are unaffected by the changes in the white-collar standard salary level for exemption. Also remember that for state and local governments, these organizations may have the option of offering compensatory time off at the rate of 1.5 hours for each hour of overtime worked. This option is generally not available to private sector employers. Now, all of these rules can be really complex and nuanced, and we don't have time to get into all of them today. So if you have any questions, we strongly suggest you consult your internal or external legal counsel.
Well, thank you, Stacey. Now, with that in mind, let's go over the FLSA update and take a look at the final rule changes effective January 1st, 2020. So, you know, we've been anticipating this change for a while. So, Stacey, can you get us started with a little bit of history on this topic?
Yeah, as we all know, the FLSA has been around for many years. And currently, to be considered exempt under any of the white-collar exemptions, the minimum salary threshold is $455 a week, which amounts to an annual salary of $23,660 a year. This threshold has not increased since 2004. In 2016, the DOL issued new regulations that would have increased the minimum salary for employees classified under the white-collar exemptions to the FLSA. And that proposal would have increased the minimum salary for exempt employees to $913 a week, or $47,476 annually. That rule, however, was blocked by a federal court, and the DOL under the Trump administration declined to continue to defend that proposal. Now, in March of 2019, the DOL released a new proposal to increase the minimum salary threshold for white-collar exempt employees to an amount not as high as was proposed under the previous administration, but which was close to what most experts had predicted and was around $35,000. The DOL released the final rule in September 2019, and that rule is summarized on your screen. The final numbers are close to, but not exactly the same as the March proposal, and we'll dig into these changes a bit deeper over the next couple of slides. To summarize, though, under the final rule, as of January 1, 2020, an employee will need to earn a salary of at least $684 a week, that is $35,568 annualized, in order to qualify as overtime exempt. That's $11,908 higher than the current level of $23,660 and represents just over a 50% increase to the current level. Remember, exempt employees must receive no less than $684 a week in each and every week they perform any work at all, subject to some limited exemptions starting 1-1-2020. Another thing to keep in mind, the FLSA salary requirements do not apply to lawyers, doctors, teachers, or outside sales employees.
Well, thank you, Stacey. Now here we have a visual representation of the FLSA weekly and annual salary thresholds. You can see the 2019 final rule minimum salary threshold of $684 per week, or the annual amount of $35,568 on the top. And the current level of $455 per week below that, and, you know, you can also see the 2016 increase amount next. And at the bottom row, you know, that basically shows you the April 2019 proposal by the DOL in the amount of $679 per week. As you can see, the 2019 final rate effective January 1st, 2020 is higher than the current threshold and 2019 proposal, but not nearly as high as the 2016 increase, you know, as that would have been. So also the new rule includes a provision that allows up to 10% of the minimum salary amount to be made up of certain non-discretionary payments. So Stacey, can you explain what that means to our audience?
Sure. So for the first time, the 2019 rule allows up to 10% of the minimum salary level to be satisfied with non-discretionary bonuses, commissions, and other incentive pay that are paid annually or more frequently. Such bonuses include, for example, non-discretionary incentive bonuses tied to productivity and profitability. So this means that if you pay an employee bonuses or commissions equal to at least $3,556.80 in the year, that employee need only be paid a guaranteed salary of $615.60 each week. Although some businesses pay very large bonuses, much larger than $3,556.80, under the rule, the amount attributable towards the white-collar standard salary level is capped at that 10% of the required salary amount, regardless of whatever total bonus is paid, unless the employee meets the highly compensated employee test, which we'll cover in a moment. So under the new rule, if an employer applies a non-discretionary bonus or incentive pay towards the salary amount, at least 90% of the salary, that's $615.60 a week, must be paid as salary, while up to 10% of that, or $68.40 a week, may be satisfied with non-discretionary bonuses or incentive payments. So that works out to a minimum of $32,011.20 in salary and up to $3,556.80 in non-discretionary bonuses, incentive payments, or commissions.
So, Stacey, are there any risks associated with applying this 10% rule?
Well, there may be. It could be a bit tricky. If you're planning to apply non-discretionary bonuses or commissions to make the $684 weekly minimum, you really need to make sure that you're able to do so consistently. That's because if you're short by any amount, even $1 in bonuses and commissions, you'll have only one pay period after the end of your fiscal year to make that additional payment. If you don't, then you'll lose the exemption and owe the employee overtime for all hours worked over 40 every week in the entire previous year. That could obviously create significant exposure. So employers who go this route will really need to closely monitor how this is working.
And Stacey, are there any exceptions to the $684 per week salary threshold for non-exempt employees?
There are a few. We've listed them on your screen. So first, employees in locations outside the continental U.S. are subject to the lower minimum specified. There is also an increase with respect to the motion picture industry exemption. Currently, an employee working in the motion picture industry who meets the duties test for exemption as an executive, administrative, or professional employee is not required to be paid on a salary basis, provided that the employee is paid a base rate of at least $695 a week. And that figure is set to increase to $1,036 a week under the new rule.
Well, thank you, Stacey. Now, here we have a visual representation of the FLSA thresholds for the highly compensated test. As you can see, the annual salary thresholds of $107,432 per year under the final rule, effective January 1st, 2020, is on the top. And then the current level of $100,000 is next, followed by the 2016 final rule in the amount of $134,004 per year. And finally, at the bottom row, you can see, you know, the April 2019 proposal by the DOL in the amount of $147,414 per year. As you can see, the January 1st, 2020 rate is higher than the current threshold, but not nearly as high as either the 2016 or the April 2019 increase would have been. So, Stacey, can you tell us a little bit more about the highly compensated employee exemption? You know, what is it, and what should our audience know about it?
Sure. So the FLSA white-collar regulations include a shorter duties test that's easier to meet for employees who are considered highly compensated. Currently, employees paid total compensation of $100,000 or more annually are considered highly compensated. Under the final rule, an employee must be paid total annual compensation of $107,432. That must include the guaranteed minimum salary of $684 a week, but the rest can be any type of compensation, commissions, bonuses, whatever. So, if you have employees who fall in the gap of earning between the $100,000 amount and the new salary level for highly compensated employees of $107,000, consider whether these employees actually meet the traditional duties test. If they don't, you may want to reclassify them or consider increasing their compensation to meet the new threshold of $107,432.
Well, thank you, Stacey. Now, under the 2016 rule, the minimum salary thresholds were set to increase automatically. Is that the case under the 2019 final rule?
Nope. Under the 2019 rule, the amounts will not automatically increase. But rather, the department proposes to review the minimum salary threshold more frequently than it has in the past, but not at any specified intervals. So now, before any new increase will take effect, the DOL will have to go through notice and comment rulemaking.
Well, thank you, Stacey. That's actually good news for the employers. Now, we also heard about the new proposed rules related to tipped employees. So what's the latest on that?
That just came out last week. The DOL proposes to finalize a rule that they announced about a year and a half ago that would allow employers that do not take a tip credit to apportion tips amongst tipped and non-tipped employees, so employees that are typically considered front of the house, like servers, and maybe back of the house, non-tipped employees, like cooks. So that's consistent with the change that we saw about a year and a half ago.
Now, Stacey, does the proposed regulation impact anything else?
It does. Another key piece of the proposal addresses what's commonly referred to as the 80-20 rule. So under this rule, employers were only permitted to apply a tip credit when employees were spending less than 20% of their shift on non-tipped work. Anything more than that, and the employees would have been entitled to earn the full minimum wage. Now, the new proposal would allow employers to take a tip credit for any amount of time that an employee performs related non-tipped duties contemporaneously with their tipped duties, or for a reasonable time immediately before or after performing the tipped duties.
Well, thank you, Stacey. Now, our next section is on compliance considerations and best practice. Now, as we all know, these new rules are set to take into effect in under 3 months, or actually 2.5 months if you think about today's date. Now, that's not a whole lot of time for employers to react. So what should employers be thinking about as a result of these changes announced by the DOL?
Well, if we remember, back in 2016, many employers got prepared. They had a plan in place to implement the increased threshold from the last administration. And then came the injunction and then the election, and those plans may have gone by the wayside. And people may be thinking, who knows, is this rule going to stick? Well, there are some groups that are planning to challenge this new rule. However, we think it's likely that this new rule is going to be upheld. And that means that employers need to take this seriously and get prepared. And the first thing you'll want to do is to consider how you're classifying your employees today.
Well, thank you, Stacey. Now, whenever there's a change in the rules, it's a good time for employers to take a closer look at the exempt, non-exempt classification. So, Stacey, what are some considerations for employers in looking at this issue?
When you're deciding whether to reclassify an employee, you'll want to look at both their salary and their job duties. In addition, while you're at it, this would be a good time to review your compensation plans, your wage and hour policies, and maybe your time and attendance policies as well.
Now, speaking of reclassification, what are some considerations for employers in light of the updated minimum salary threshold?
Well, given the changes in the salary threshold, especially for employees who met the old salary threshold but won't meet the new one, you may consider evaluating whether the job duties performed by those employees, and maybe all of your exempt employees, meet the current requirements for an overtime exemption. Even if salary level is not an issue, you may have employees who don't really meet the duties requirement for exemption under the current regulations. And the DOL's revision to the regulations provide a rare opportunity to correct these classification issues with somewhat of a reduced risk of triggering litigation. How long has it been since you conducted an exemption audit? With other employees in the workforce being reclassified because of the salary issue, it might be a good time to conduct an audit of the job duties of some portion of your exempt workforce.
So, Stacey, that addresses the duties test. How should employers be thinking about salary decisions?
Well, you'll need to pull the salary and incentive pay data for all employees earning near or below the $35,568 minimum salary effective 1/1/2020. And you'll want to consider each employee's current salary and the total incentive payments, like bonuses, commissions, et cetera, that they received in 2018. And then subtract that total compensation amount from the new minimum salary level. This will calculate the cost of increasing the salary of that employee up to the new minimum. You'll also want to calculate and compare the cost of paying these employees overtime. If the employees don't often work more than 40 hours in the week, the better business decision may be to reclassify them as non-exempt. The biggest challenge, though, will be to determine the number of hours that these employees usually work, as most likely they're not tracking their hours since they're currently classified as exempt. To do this, you'll need to do some fact-finding. That will take time, and that's a reason to start now. Talk to your managers. Consider questionnaires to the employees. If you think reclassification is likely, you could consider even beginning to have those employees clock in and out now so you can accumulate the data you need.
Well, thank you, Stacey. This is very helpful. So let's take a look at some of the best practices as it relates to time and pay, starting with calculating overtime and regular rate of pay. Now, the first thing to remember is to calculate the regular rate of pay each week, not each pay period. It doesn't matter what your pay frequency is. Overtime is calculated on a weekly basis. Also, remember to tell your provider which pay codes need to be included in the overtime calculation. In general, what's included are pay tied to hours worked, production, or efficiency, basically pay associated with quality and quantity of work. And if you don't have a provider and are doing this yourself, you need to ensure accuracy in your own overtime calculations. You also need to carefully consider the beginning and end dates of your non-exempt employees' bonus and commission periods in order to calculate that overtime correctly. And make sure you include shift differentials, on-call pay, prizes, and awards appropriately. And most importantly, when in doubt, refer to your legal counsel, as these issues can be complex. Now, another thing to think about is that calculating overtime correctly starts with tracking hours worked, which is often challenging. But that can be even more challenging for salaried non-exempt employees. So think about this. Do you have salaried non-exempt employees? That's the key question to ask yourself. And if you do, how are they tracking hours? You know, where are their hours stored? And how accurate is the information? Now, the best practice is to use electronic timekeeping and track time starting immediately for all impacted employees to better understand the impact, just like Stacey said. Now, this can be challenging and require both communication as well as change management, as employees may perceive this negatively. So you really, really have to be very careful as to how you communicate and who you communicate with and, you know, who actually communicates the message or gives the message. Also, a general best practice is to require employees to punch in and out when they begin and stop working. And don't assume that the scheduled hours were the actual hours worked, because generally speaking, they usually aren't. The best practice is to pay to the punch for actual time worked without rounding. Now, an important thing to remember is that rounding is permitted provided it accurately compensates employees. So employers must be able to demonstrate that about half of the employee's time is rounded down and half is rounded up. And they can get into trouble with rounding if there's a reason to believe that rounding is always or actually even more often applied in a way that benefits employers and reduces employees' wages. Now, another best practice is to use attestation, requiring employees to review and approve their time cards or the hours worked in advance of pay. Now, this also gives you an opportunity to make corrections if your employee encounters any mistakes. And finally, leveraging one solution for both payroll and time tracking is optimal. If you're using two different vendors or tools, make sure you have integration in place to ensure accuracy. Now, as you can see from everything we've covered today, the bottom line is that you have to keep up with compliance, document everything, and make sure your policies and procedures are consistent and help mitigate risk. And finally, when in doubt, don't forget to consult with your legal advisor. So with that, I'm going to pass it back to Karen. So Karen, back to you.
Thank you so much, Sushma and Stacey, for all that valuable information you were able to deliver in, I know, a 30-minute period of time. So unfortunately, based on timing, this does conclude our event for today. To receive ongoing communications from ADP on regulatory and legislative guidelines and deadlines and keeping up on things such as this DOL overtime rule change, please subscribe to our Ion Washington email alerts by visiting the link shown on the screen or indicate you'd like to opt in on the event survey. We also encourage you to register for additional Workplace Spotlight webinars, such as our October 24th webinar on benefits trends and compliance updates, using the link shown on the screen. And on behalf of Sushma, Stacy, myself, and the entire team at ADP, we thank you for joining us today and look forward to having you join us for future Workplace Spotlight events. Thank you so much and have a great rest of your day.